Well, hey, welcome to First Church. So glad you guys are joining us here today. Whether you are on site or online, we are excited that you chose to carve out some time and worship with our First Church family. And I just looked, and online, we've got Seth, who's in Africa, worshiping with us right now. We've got Drake, who's at Fire Station 28, who's serving our community, worshiping with us. Tiffany's in Kansas City. Travis is in Cancun. We're all jealous. And the Tripp family, they are somewhere in the desert in California. Hopefully, they find their way back. But if you are here on site, would you put your hands together? Welcome in our online family. Excited to have them worshiping with us here today. And I'm excited about all the positive feedback we received from the big announcement we made last Sunday. If you weren't here, as of August the 6th, we are going to be offering 3 worship services on Sunday morning to accommodate our growth. And we are so pumped about this. If you can't tell, I mean, it is summer right now, and this room is pretty full. We need to make more room for more people, especially at our 9:30 hour. And so we're going to be changing our service times. We'll be adding an 8:15 service, 9:45, and 11:15 will be our new times. This will help alleviate parking issues and issues upstairs in First Kids and also on down the hall in First Years. And we are excited about this opportunity for more and more people to come and worship with us. But we need your help. We need some people to plan on, volunteer, to both attend the 8:15 service, also serve it, but maybe attend the 8:15 service and like serve our kids at another time as well. And so if you are able to attend or you're thinking about attending our 8:15 service, we have a QR code right here. You can scan it right now while it's up on the screen. Let us know that you are thinking about attending this service. You're not necessarily committing to where you're locked in from now till Jesus comes back, you know, to come to our 8:15 service. But if you are interested, we would just like to know that, or if you're interested in volunteering, like some people may want to volunteer in First Kids but then attend another service, that's fine too. You can scan this QR code. There's a spot for you to put down what you're interested in, and we would like to get back with you because we want to start planning now for this 8:15 service to be a huge service, just like our 9:45 will be and our 11:15 as well. So we are so pumped about what God is doing in this place, and we are just making more and more room for more people to come and know the good news about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and hopefully you're excited about it as well. But I'm not just excited about our future service, I'm also excited about what's taking place today. Today, we are launching our annual summer sermon series, Mixtape. And I know a lot of people look forward to this series every single year as we talk about music and it takes some people back and we have some nostalgic moments and all that kind of stuff. But some people have said, and maybe you would argue with me on this, but some people have said that the decade of the 80s was the golden age of music. Anybody agree with that? Yeah. Now, some people would disagree with that. Anybody disagree with that statement? Okay, well, that's all right. Boy, well, there's a lot of you. Okay. Wow. Okay, all right. Vocal about that. Can't get an amen, but I'll get that response right there. Okay, great. But whether you agree or disagree that the 80s, that decade was a golden age of music, you have to admit, there were some epic songs that came out of the 80s. And I like to play a few clips here with you, and I want to see if you can recognize these songs just by a few seconds of playing it. So here's our first one. Pay careful attention. All right, anybody know it? Don't Stop Believing by Journey. Okay, that's a pretty easy one. This next one might be a little bit more difficult. I doubt it, though. Play this next one. Okay, anybody know the name of the song? Oh, it's U2. Yeah, that's the group. But what's the name of the song? With or Without You, right down front. Yeah, somebody had it. Awesome. A little bit more difficult. This last one's going to be really easy. It's one of my favorites. Go ahead. Yeah, you know what? We can just pray and go home after that, you know? Isn't that awesome? Okay, what's the name of the song? Yeah, Living on a Prayer by Bon Jovi. Awesome. By the way, in case you didn't know, according to VH1, that was the number one song of the 80s. Now, you may disagree with that, but that's what VH1 says. There are a lot of epic songs that came out of the 80s. But something else that the 1980s were also known for was popularizing the mixtape. Now, this probably brings back some memories for some of you. Some of you are probably thinking, what in the world is that? And so, in case you don't know, before music went digital, okay, there are these things called cassette tapes. And I've got one right here. And you would actually listen to music off of these things right here. And in fact, I need to explain this because I went to an antique store. I went to a couple of them this week trying to find some cassettes. And I know I went to an antique store to buy cassettes. But while I was there, I asked one of the girls who was working, like, do you guys have any cassettes? And she said, oh yeah, we got a whole booth full of them. I was like, great. So she took me to that booth and it was a booth full of CDs. I was like, no, those aren't cassettes. Those are CDs. And no joke, she said, what's the difference? Like, she did not know the difference. Man, I never felt so old than in that moment right there, honestly. But you would have tapes, cassette tapes like this that would have songs on it. But if you wanted to make a mixtape, or what we would call a playlist of your favorite songs, it was a lot more complicated and time-consuming than what we're able to do now. You know, now you just go on like Amazon Music or Apple Music or Spotify or whatever, you make a playlist. But in this, back in the day, you had to have a stack of your favorite cassettes, or maybe you would get them off the radio, you listen to songs off the radio, and you would put a cassette in right here, like that, and if you had a dual cassette, you would have a blank tape, which would be your mixtape. And you would put this one in here as well, and you had to get the pause and record and stop and play just right, you know. But you would play a song here, and then you would hit record over here. So let's go ahead and see if this will work here. I'm gonna hit record and play. Another classic, Paradise City, by the way, which, by the way, I found out came out in 89, so it is an 80s song, barely, but it is an 80s song. And let's see here if this works. So let me rewind real fast and see if it worked. I don't know. I got this at the antique store, too, so I'm not sure if it's going to work or not. There it is. And there is our mixtape. And so you would put a whole bunch of different songs on your mixtape, and you would make a mixtape for like a road trip, or maybe for somebody that you liked, you know, your significant other, maybe some love songs. You make a mixtape with just some of your favorite jams or tunes, whatever. And when you were done, when you had a tape full of songs, you had a masterpiece. And believe it or not, there is a masterpiece that we're given in the Bible, which kind of is a mixtape of songs, worship songs and prayers. We call it the Book of Psalms. And the Book of Psalms, well, it's more than just poetry. It's a book of songs written by great people of God who worshiped God and prayed to him and recorded their songs, the lyrics to their songs for us. And for generations, for thousands of years, people have turned to the Book of Psalms for guidance and strength and comfort. And there are different types of psalms, just like there are different types of music today. You know, we don't use the same type of music in every circumstance. Like the type of music that we would play at a ball game or a sporting event, it's not the same music you would play at a wedding, right? Or at a funeral for that matter, or maybe a kid's birthday party. There are different types of songs for different occasions. And there are different types of psalms for different occasions as well. There are psalms that are celebratory psalms where people are excited and praising God. There are psalms that teach us things. There are psalms that go back and study history. And there are psalms that also help us through the low points in life. And out of the 150 psalms that we're given in this book, over half of them are attributed to this guy named David, who you've probably heard of before. This is the same David who defeated the giant Goliath and who later became king of Israel. And David is known for a lot of things. But one thing that we're told in Scripture is that God considered David a man after my own heart, a man after God's own heart. How would you like to have that reputation? How cool would that be that forever in the Bible, forever in Scripture, you were known for being a man after God's own heart? What a cool, cool description, cool reputation to have. And what's interesting is we're given a whole lot about David's life in Scripture, you know, the history of his life. But because we have the Psalms, we're also told a lot about what's going on inside of David as well, in his heart, in his soul. And I think this is so important because we live in a day and age that's all about image management. That's all about looking at the outside and looking good, especially on social media, right? We've got to put just the right picture up, just the right post up so that we look good on the outside. And a lot of times we don't take the time to examine the inside examine our hearts, examine our souls, to make sure that we are right with God, to make sure that we are in a healthy place with Him. And that's why I love the Psalms, because we get a look into David's heart, into what's going on in his soul, so that we can examine ourselves and make sure that we are where we need to be. Now, most of the time when we turn to the Psalms, we are looking for, you know, like words of encouragement or maybe words of celebration and praise. And many of David's Psalms especially, they just overflow with praise. But sometimes when David writes a Psalm, he's in a really, really dark place, a low place. And instead of pouring out praise, David pours out his troubles. He pours out his anxiety and stress. And we're going to look at a psalm like that today. And it may be an odd place to start off this mixtape series, but psalms like the one that we're going to look at today are often neglected, but I think they're in there for a reason, and they can teach us something really, really powerful for our lives. So we're going to look today at Psalm 142. And it comes as David is in a cave, a dark, dingy, dirty cave, all by himself, feeling all alone, feeling deserted by all of his friends and all the people who he thought cared about him. He is running for his life right now because the king of Israel at this point, Saul, wants to kill him. David is at a really, really low point in his life. And from this dark, dingy cave, David writes this psalm. And listen to the opening words of this psalm. I cry aloud to the Lord. So he is crying out loud. Like, he's not praying silently here. He is shouting out to God. He is crying out loud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint before him. Before him, I tell my trouble. Now that's an interesting line there. I pour out my complaint. Like I said, we're used to David pouring out praise. But notice what he says, I pour out my complaint. He starts off this psalm, this worship song, complaining to God. Now we're not used to that. In fact, that's not typical when it comes to most of our worship music, is it? And I dare say some of you are probably thinking, is that even allowed? Like, can we do that, you know? Are we allowed to complain to God, to just pour out our trouble like that to God? I mean, we sang a song earlier today. It's called Same God. And if you remember the lyrics of how that song starts, it's a cool song. I love this song. It's a powerful, powerful worship song. But it starts off by saying, I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I mean, those are strong, powerful words. I love how that song begins. But what if the song started with these words instead? I'm calling on the God of Jacob because I have some complaints to make. I'm so sad right now, my whole body aches. I mean, what if that's how the psalm started? By the way, I wrote those lyrics. You guys didn't know I was a songwriter, did you? Yeah, I did. I can do it. See, it's not that hard. Anyway, but just got to rhyme a little bit, right? No, I'm kidding. But what if that's how that song started? I mean, is that going to get you fired up for worship? I mean, are you going to be pumped? You're probably thinking, why did I come to church today? They're going to sing songs like that. But isn't that sometimes how we feel in life? I mean, don't we have days where we just don't feel right or we feel down or discouraged? I love the fact that there are psalms like Psalm 142 in the Bible because it reminds me that feeling sad doesn't mean you're unspiritual. It just means you're human because we live in a fallen world. And the way this world is right now is not how God originally created it to be. And sometimes our hearts are going to break in this world. Feeling sad doesn't mean you're unspiritual. Doesn't mean you're a bad person. It just means that you're human. Because if a man who is known for being a man after God's own heart can feel sad at times, I think it's okay if we do as well. The question is, where will you let your sadness take you? Where will you let your sadness take you? Because it can take you to an unhealthy spot. It can take you to bitterness or anxiety or stress or fear or loneliness or whatever. It can lead you to anger and hate and all sorts of stuff. Sadness can take you to a very, very dark place if you'll let it. But our sadness can also bring us back to God. if we will turn to him in those moments. And that's what David does here. See, I learned a long time ago, and this is a profound truth that has changed my life. Who you run to matters more than what you're running from. Who you run to is much more significant than what you're running from. Let me give you an example of this. I've been a dad now for almost 10 years, and I don't have near as much, you know, parenting experience as some of you guys do. I get that. But in my 10 years of being a dad, both my son and daughter at times have come into mine and Allison's room in the middle of the night scared because they've had a bad dream. And when they come into our room scared, sometimes they know why they're scared because they had a dream about, you know, whatever. But sometimes they don't even know why they're scared. Like on more than one occasion, I've had one of them tell me, "Daddy, I can't remember what my dream was about, but I'm scared." And what impresses me in that moment, what stands out to me in that moment, is that they can't remember why they're scared, but they know who to run to when they are scared. It's the same thing with God and us. Like, I'm gonna be very transparent with you. There are a lot of things in this world that are scary, aren't there? This world is full of things that frighten us and scare us. This world is full of darkness, but who we run to matters more than what we are running from, because we can always run to our Heavenly Father who is bigger than anything we are facing in this dark world. That's the confidence that we have, and we have a Father who loves us, who wants to meet us where we are, even if where we are is a dark, dark spot. See, David, in this moment, he's really struggling. This isn't like David is just, you know, having a hangnail and he's, you know, upset about it. I mean, David's really struggling. Listen to what he goes on to say in this psalm. He says, "In the path where I walk, men have hidden a snare for me, a trap for me. Look to my right." Now, he's talking to God here, remember. "Look to my right and see, God. No one is concerned for me. Nobody cares about me. Nobody's here with me. I have no refuge. No one cares for my life." Just so you don't miss what David is saying, look at how another translation translates these verses. "Wherever I go, my enemies have set traps for me. I look for someone to come and help me, but no one gives me a passing thought." You ever felt that way? You ever been in one of those moments where everywhere you turn, it seems like there's a trap waiting for you? Ever had one of those moments when everybody who you thought cared about you doesn't seem to care about you? You ever had one of those moments where you just feel like you're all alone in a dark, dark place? That's where David is right now. Now, David's life hadn't always been like this. In fact, I imagine that at one point in David's life, he never thought he would get to a cave like this. I mean, think about it. It wasn't that long ago that a prophet of God came to David's father's house and said, "David's gonna be the future king of Israel." And this prophet announced this in front of David's dad, in front of all of his brothers. You know, sometimes, like for example, Joseph, he had to like sell his brothers on the fact that he was special. You know, they didn't want to believe it. David's brothers knew it. David's brothers heard the prophet say, "He's gonna be the future king of Israel." And David's life was special from that point on. I mean, he defeated like a lion and a bear. He defeats the giant Goliath, the enemy of God's people. And Saul, the king in that time, honors David. And he even gives David his own daughter to marry. David gets to marry the daughter of the king, the princess. And then David becomes this mighty warrior and everybody's singing his praises. I mean, everywhere David goes, people are singing songs about him and his mighty victories. David is on cloud nine. And it's obvious that he's special. It's obvious that God is with him. But when we get to Psalm 142, the situation has changed. Because King Saul, who had once honored and celebrated David, well, he's become jealous of David. And so he sets a trap for David and he wants to kill David. Side note, there are some people in life who will keep you around as long as they can use you. But the moment that you become a threat to them, or the moment that they feel like they can't control you anymore, they will cast you aside. And that's Saul. Saul liked having David around when David was playing music for him and comforting him. Saul liked having David around when he was helping him out. But the moment that Saul saw David as a threat. He wanted him dead. People can turn on us, but God never does. And so in this moment, David is now running for his life because Saul is out to get him. And David has to flee from his homeland. And he ends up going to the town, the city of Gath. And that may not mean anything to you at all, but Gath is where Goliath was from. So David has to go to the town where his enemy was from. And they don't like him there either. In fact, David's still carrying the sword that he took off of Goliath when he defeated him. And so he comes to town and they want to kill him there. And so David has to act like he's a madman, act like he's crazy so that they won't kill him. And he can't stay there forever. Eventually, he's got to leave. Now, I just want you to process what's going on here. David can't stay in his homeland because Saul wants to kill him. He can't stay in the land of his enemies because his enemies want to kill him. You ever feel like you don't belong anywhere? That's David right now. And so he goes to this cave to be all alone, to find safety. David goes, to steal some 80s song lyrics, David goes from, believe it or not, I'm walking on air, to literally living on a prayer. He's got nowhere else to turn but God because everybody else has deserted him. And this just reminds me of another key truth. The presence of trouble doesn't equal the absence of God. See, God's still with David, and David's going to figure this out. God still has a future for David. God still has a plan for David. But just because he's experiencing this trouble doesn't mean that God has abandoned him. And sometimes we believe, and people even tell us, and sometimes churches even hint at this, whether they mean to or not. But if you're going through trouble, you caused it. Like, if you're going through trouble, something must not be right in your life. If you're going through trouble, then you've done something. And that's not what the Bible teaches. Even a guy who's known for being a man after God's own heart went through trouble. Jesus even tells us this. Jesus says, in this world, you will have trouble. And he's speaking to his followers, by the way. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Jesus says, you're going to have trouble. But don't let your trouble trouble you. Because I'm greater than your troubles. See, what we see as times of trouble, God uses as times of training. God uses it as moments in order to grow us, to help us become who he needs us to be for the future because he has future plans for us. And sometimes in those moments of trouble is when we get the closest to God. I have a friend who often says that what we go through, we grow through. And I think that is so true. And I can look back on my life and there have been seasons and moments when I have gone through some really, really bad experiences that I would never, ever, ever want to repeat. I would never want to go back to. But looking back on those moments and what I learned during those times, I would not trade what I learned during that season. Even though I would never go back there, I would not trade what I learned because in those moments of trouble, God used me. He trained me to be who he wanted me to be. But not only that, I drew closer to him than what I had ever been. And that's what happens for David in this moment. David pours out his complaints to God. And I love that David feels comfortable enough to do this. Because sometimes we think, you know, in order to, like, for God to hear us, then we need to say just the right religious words, and we need to be just in the right religious context, and we need to have just the right religious mindset. And unless we have all the stars aligned, spiritually, religiously speaking, then God doesn't hear us or God doesn't want to hear from us. And that's not the case at all. God is a father who always wants to hear from his children, even on their bad days. And he meets us where we are because God's presence is always a safe space for us to deal with our emotions. He wants to help us navigate the emotions that we are feeling, our fears, our anxieties, our pain, our hurt, our suffering, whatever it is, he wants to be there for us. And I believe we are closest to God when we're real with him. Not when we're putting on a religious show. Not when we're saying the right words, you know, thee after thou, except after thine, or whatever, you know. It's not when we're just using this religious King James-y language or something like that. It's not just when we're in church. I think when we are real with God, genuine with him, authentic with him, That's when we get closest to him. And here's the thing, you can try to put on a good show, but God knows what's really going on anyway. So who are you fooling? He knows what's really going on in your heart. He knows how you are really feeling. That's why I love verses like Romans 8:15. When Paul writes that God has adopted us as his own children, and so now we are able to call him Abba, Father. Because that word Abba was a personal term that children would use for their dad. Abba, Father. And one thing about my kids, I always want them to feel safe and comfortable to come to me, even when they mess up, even when they have bad days. Now, I know as they get older and they're teenagers, there's gonna be a lot of things they probably wanna hide from me. I get that, I'm not stupid. I was a teenager once too. But I'm telling them now, before they get there, that even when you mess up, even when you have a bad day, even when you're embarrassed, I will always be your dad, and I will always love you. Now, I might give you some advice you don't wanna hear in that moment, but I'm still gonna love you. I'm still gonna be there for you. You will always have a place in my home because you are my child. And when we come to God in the midst of our troubles, in the midst of our stresses, even when we mess up, when we turn to him, he always has a place for us around his table. And David knows that because he's so close with God, he feels like I can be real with God. I don't have to put on a religious show. I don't have to say the right spiritual magic words for God to hear me. I know I can be real with God and God will meet me where I am right now. David knows that when you feel like worshiping the least is when you need it the most. You've probably heard me say that before, because there have been times that I have turned to God in worship and I have not felt like worshiping. But that's what I needed, because in the presence of God, our earthly fears assume their proper size. In the presence of God, we realize just how small we are and how big he is. In the presence of God, we realize how small our problems are and how big he is. In the presence of God, our entire perspective changes. You probably recognize this picture right here. This is the Apollo 11 crew. First men to ever step foot on the moon are in this picture right here. And something you may not know is that Buzz Aldrin, who's over here on the far side, before he stepped on the moon, he was the second, you know, Neil Armstrong was first. Before he stepped on the moon, before both of them got to walk on the moon, they had some downtime. And so Buzz Aldrin asked NASA, can we have radio silence for a few minutes? And NASA said, sure. And you know what Buzz Aldrin did in that moment when he had that radio silence? NASA tried to cover this up for years, but it's recorded in history. Buzz Aldrin took communion on the moon, the Lord's Supper. NASA didn't want anybody to know that because they thought it might offend people. But Buzz Aldrin is a strong man of faith. And before he stepped foot on the moon, he wanted to remember his Lord and Savior. Because you know, it's one thing to step foot on the moon. It's another thing to know the one who created the moon. In the presence of God, our fears assume their proper size. In the presence of God, we see things differently. It changes everything. And that's what David is experiencing in Psalm 142. Look at what he says in verse 3. It says, when my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who know my way. In other words, God, you know the way out of this cave. You still have plans for me. You still have a future for me. And I know it looks bad and it's dark and it's dingy and it's smelly in this cave, but I know that you are still in control and you know what is best for me. What David here is basically saying is this: God, you haven't brought me this far to leave me here. You haven't brought me this far to fail me now, and the same is true for you and me. You may feel like you're in a cave right now. You may feel like that people are abandoning you right now. You may feel unloved right now. You may feel like that you are failing right now. I don't know what situation you're in, but God does, and God has not brought you to this point to leave you now. He is still with you, and no cave is too big for him to handle. David knows that. And so he prays, God, you know the way out of this cave. I'm willing to do whatever you want for me to do. And this whole psalm is written in the context, the historical context of 1 Samuel chapter 22. And look what happens. God sends a prophet to David. He sends some other people as well, some of his family and different people, but he sends a prophet. And David meets the prophet outside of the cave that he was in. And look at what it says. It says, the prophet Gad told David, don't go back to the cave, go to Judah. Wait a second, that's where Saul is. That's where the man is who wants to kill me. The prophet says, don't go back to the cave. You're done there. Go to Judah. God will go before you. He'll be with you. God has a future for you. The same is true for us today. And that's why David is able to end this psalm with these words. Even though we see in verses 5 and 6 that he's desperate and he says, hey, what I'm dealing with is too strong for me. He then turns it all over to God, and look at how he wraps up this psalm. He says, set me free from my prison that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. What is David saying? David is saying, I'm going to get the chance to tell about what happened to me in the cave. I'm going to get a chance to tell about this season of my life, and this season of my life will cause other people to praise God. God is going to use this season down the road in order to bring glory to his name. David knows that our greatest testimonies often come out of our greatest troubles, that God is going to use this moment for his greater purpose. And the same promise is true for us as well. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you're dealing with, no cave is too big for our God. And he still has a future for you. He has not abandoned you in your cave. And your cave doesn't have to be the end of your story. Because you know what? David wasn't the only king who ever spent some time in a cave. There was another king, years after David, who was arrested, put on trial for something he didn't do, sentenced to be executed, put on a cross. And when he died, they put his lifeless body in a tomb, which was basically a cave. And they put a big stone in front of it and they sealed it shut. And the world said, Satan said, that's the end of Jesus' story. This cave, this tomb will forever define Jesus of Nazareth. And they were right. That cave did forever define Jesus, but not in the way that they thought, because he didn't stay in that cave. He didn't stay in that tomb. On the third day, he walked out alive with resurrection power. Because no cave is too big for our God to handle. And because Jesus walked out of the tomb, we today know that we have hope beyond whatever trouble, whatever situation, whatever stress, whatever cave we're dealing with today. And so today, if you're living on a prayer, that's actually the only way to live. Because if you're living on anything else but your relationship with God, you're gonna be stuck in a cave. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for today and this time we've had to open up your word and to learn from this ancient psalm written by King David. And we just pray, Father, that we would take these words and use them as words of encouragement for our lives, knowing that nothing we face is too big for you. May we always turn to you even in the midst of our troubles, and you wanna hear even our complaints, because you are the way out of whatever cave we find ourselves in. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen.